So basically, I am covering certain reforms which are related to registration and land record. So the first one is related to reform number 65, which is digitized deeds. We know that sub-registrar office is very important in the land administration. Technically speaking, sub-registrar is the crown's witness. While all of us can be called to court for giving witness, sub-registrar is not expected to be called because Crown's witness cannot be questioned. Once he signs, it should be taken as final. So any certified record from sub-registrar office means a registered document proving that is not needed by calling the sub-registrar. And a proper copy, registered copy of the deed is supposed to be final. Now, that is a legal position. But as far as the reforms are concerned, while this is legally very important, getting a copy of the digitized deed, is always a problem. You have to apply olden days, you have to hand copy it and get it signed. Nowadays it is xeroxed and then signed. But the reform is that can people get it sitting at home, sitting anywhere? So digitization of deeds involves two type of work. One is providing the transaction history, two, giving the copy of registered documents. Transaction history is called by various names, index to copy or encumbrance certificate. Some of our states issue encumbrance certificate officially by the sub-registrar, signed by sub-registrar. Some of the states do not give. They only permit people to search the index to register. Now, in both cases, we have to digitize and make it available. While index to registers are the transaction history, as all of us know, these are kept as registers or after the computation has started, it is available in the computer. But wherever the manual record is there, they have to be, data has to be entered. It is nothing but, index 2 is nothing but metadata of the document registered. Now, this data entry has to take place. But to be frank, it is not a big job because the data to be entered per deed is around 7 to 8 columns. The year, document number, who is a seller, who is a purchaser, which village and which survey number is involved. This can be done maybe within 2 months if you take it as a mission mode project, and this we have done for 30 years for Mumbai and 18 years for the rest of Maharashtra. The other one is that soft copy of deed should be made available online. So first you find out whether this property has been transacted, how many times transacted and how many times for in the past 12 years, some people take 12 years, some people take 30 years. And after that, suppose that particular transaction is relevant to you, then you ask for a certified copy. Now, this should also be made available online, and available online means basically this is not fully digitized. This is a scanned copy of documents, but metadata is available in the digital format so that searching is possible. Because it cannot be fully digital because it has to be scanned copy, scanned document of the original. So this should also be made available. Again, most of the states must have computerized at least in the past 10 to 15 years. So if you are starting from 2005 or 2008 or 2010, these documents are already available. The only problem is that most of the states are, or some of the states are not making it available online. It has to be received from the concerned SRO office. The only work we need to do for this period, I mean, after post-computerization of registration, is that taking it and putting it in the available in the web, putting the scanned copies with a, I mean, search facility and download automatically. We can go a step further whereby we can make a digitally signed documents available that will ensure that people need not come to our office for getting a certified copy. This can be done in two ways. One is bulk digital signing. So if you are very sure about the scanned copies are under your control, bulk signature of the, all the documents may be 100, 200, 500 can be done. Otherwise, another model is that this can be given, digital sign can be done on the fly. Whenever there is a request, it can be signed. Now, what are the challenges? Basically, digitization and data entry of manually registered documents, we have to enter it sometime. These registers are torn. We have to ensure that there is no wrong entries. In case the registers are torn, we have to go back to the original document or the copy of the document to see and put the same information. The original document will have the information. Who is a seller, who is a purchaser, which number is involved, etc. So basically, the way is to appoint special teams along with support. Our people are always overloaded with our regular work. So some people have to be separately given, and this is something which can be easily outsourced. The scanning and data entry can be outsourced, but the responsibility should be under our people. And the way to ensure responsibility is that whoever is a supervising employee or officer of our people, they have to digitally sign this post destation and scanning. This is the first one. And the reform number 66 is digitized record of right. Many states have done this, including Karnataka's Bhumi, which was the leader in digitization of record of rights. There is a report issued by National Council for Applied Economic Research, NCER. This is available online. You can go for Land Reforms Index, NCER, Google it, you will get it. Various states are ranked on various criteria related to all parameters on land, whether it is ROR, whether it is registration, whether it is cadastral map. Please see the report. You will find out what are the parameters on which it is assessed and what is your ranking. You can climb up if you are concentrating on the various parameters which are mentioned here, which is similar to EODV parameters. EODV parameters are the state reform parameters are outcomes, but the NCER gives details. Thank you. And there are two things to be done. One is digitization of data, and the second thing is that verification using digital signature. What happens with the digitization of data is that many states have done digitization of data. To be frank, digitization of ROR going from a pilot project in 1988, it failed mainly in those days, because once digitization is over, two things needs to be done which was not done during those days. Now the way to do that, like if you go down the last but one point, to ensure that the document or the record is correct, it has to be digitally signed by the person who is digitizing. Concerned patwari, concerned circle officer, and random checking by higher level officers has to be done. And the person who is digitizing has to digitally sign. That puts a responsibility. Till there is a change, it is going to be issued under the signature of the person who has digitized. So that puts a responsibility. Point number two, the only way to keep it updated is to close down manual record of rights. Whether it is Sadbara, whether it is Adangal, whether it is Kathauni, once the digitization is done, we need not wait for the entire state to happen. Once the taluka is over, or you can go up to even village level, once it is done, we have to declare that from this date onwards, manual entries, manual modification, manual mutations are not permitted. An order has to be issued. That is one thing which needs to be done. So if both the things are done, it's not very difficult to take it forward. Maharashtra in 2014 stopped manual Sadbara. After that also, there were some errors we found by running the queries in our database. We have 41 cross-check reports. These reports point out various errors, inconsistencies in data. They get cleared in due course, and without clearing that, it cannot be digitally signed. So digitize, verify, digitally sign, close manual record of right. This is a process we have to undertake, and then this should be made available online. Again, this should be freely available online, in the sense that why it is freely, it's not monetary wise. It should not be restricted only to our citizen service centers. Citizen service center should not become another agency. It should be there, but it should not be exclusive. In fact, after making it available in the website on payment of 15 rupees, lakhs of records have been downloaded from our website. And so far, Maharashtra has collected nearly 10 crores in the past 6 to 7 months of putting it online. And another thing is sustainability. Please ensure that we open a separate account for this with the government's permission and use it to run the system. Otherwise, if you rely on government budget for small things, maintenance become difficult. This is another thing. Third thing is that one of the interesting thing of computerization is that while we computerize everything, two computerized departments ask the farmer and the citizen to manually move around. For example, if someone wants to take a Prime Minister Fasal Bima Yojana, he has to come to a computerized ROR system, take a printout, and go to the online system of Bima Yojana and give the paper copy and scan and upload. This is not done. This is left hand and right hand of the same governmental system as digital system, but we are making a manual movement of the customer and citizen. So in Maharashtra, we have integrated with DPT, we have integrated with Bima Yojana, Okra, National E-Market Limited, and banks. 14 banks have linked up with our server so that if they want to verify before giving loan, they can verify. So major challenges are because unlike a document, registration document, we call it as a fire and forget. The document registered is frozen. There is no editing permitted. Very rarely there is a provision under Registration Act to change. But record of rights is dynamic. It will change as per the crops. It will change when there is a inheritance entry. It will change whenever there is a registration change. So this is a big challenge because while you are digitizing, there will be more changes. You have to put a cutoff date and do that. We'll go to the next point. Reform number 70, digitized cadastral maps. If you see the NCER report, while the ROR and registration has been done by most of the states, digitized cadastral map is something which is lagging behind by and large. So there are two types of or three types of systems in the country. One is village maps are kept and changes are updated in the village level map only. Village level map has polygons of individual thing and updated. Many states have another system, what is called TIPAN, what is called FMB. So in the FMB, the individual parcels are measured and the details are there. That has to be digitized. And third thing is that apart from these TIPANs, you have further updation by way of land acquisition, subdivision, extra, the different maps are there. Now, what is needed for cadastral maps here is that the person should know which part of the land he is purchasing. So we have to digitize the maps. This is not very difficult. If we can employ even a semi-government agency like Remote Sensing Application Center of your state, most of the states have Remote Sensing Application Center. They can easily do that for you. For example, our maps, all the maps are digitized by, the village level maps are digitized by MRSAC, Maharashtra Remote Sense Application Center. So once this is done, the biggest advantage is that the cadastral map and the ROR which we have digitized, if they can be integrated, then the people not only know that what they are purchasing, they will also come to know that with which part of the land they are purchasing, whether that part of the land is being sold already or not. This is possible. So for Maharashtra, we have just uploaded our MRSAC digitized map to a portal developed by NIC. It is called Bhunaksha, and this is a software prepared by NIC under DOLR, Department of Land Resources, and it is available to all the states free of cost. They can help you to host immediately and then you can run it on your own. So by hosting this, you are basically integrating not only hosting of maps, but hosting of data also. If you can see the bottom map, you can see on the left side the details of ownership. So this is something which makes life much easier for the people to know which property they are purchasing, what is the, whether the area written in the ROR correct or not. There are some challenges and how we have to do that is also mentioned. You can go through. Then the most important thing is that most of the time we are looking into computerization as an end in itself for the department. We don't look it from the citizen point of view. From the citizen point of view, he is not bothered about which department he is interacting with. What is his objective in purchasing a property? He wants to search whether the title is clear or not. Then he wants to see the property card or sadbara, that means record of rights. He might be interested in property tax dues if the property tax dues are generally heavy. Then he also wants to search whether there are any encumbrance in the registrar office. then some people, especially EODB mandates, that whether any charges are there with the ROC. Now basically it's a portal where you put the details. You can see at the bottom right hand every service is separately given, and we can go and click and get this service. This is a portal. It can be written in 1 or 2 months easily, or if anyone wants, we can share our code also. This is also prepared by NIC Pune. Once you put, you have to link it to your sister databases like ROR and registration. Then this is easily available. While we within the system feel that it is not very difficult, but for a common person, running into even 5-6 databases is very difficult. Put it in a single place, and this is now functional in Maharashtra, and people are making use of that. Now, what are the challenges? Because we have to interact with many government of India and state departments, it became difficult. But thanks to EODB lead taken by DPIIT, these things fell in line, and we are having the services which are mentioned here. Whether it is Ministry of Corporate Affairs, whether it is CERSAI, which keeps the mortgage records of the banks, then the e-courts, etc. We are having e-courts. We still have some issues because the data is not based on the survey number. So we still need to work further, but other things have been integrated. This is 71. Now it is 74 and 78. This is about a dashboard. So basically, we should have a dashboard where whatever we are claiming that we have done, the relevant data should be made available for public to view. Suppose if you are saying that people can do their purchase within 30 days, we should be in a position to give it in our website. So many people could finish it within 30 days, and so many people, because of maybe some disputes or something, it took 90 days or maybe 6 months. But this information needed to be put. You know that this is not a big issue, because once your backend is computerized, whether it is ROR, whether the registration, the total revenue collected, total document registered, etc., is very easy. So this can be made available easily. Another thing which is very important is that registered document should be given within a day, within the same day. This is not a very difficult thing for states which have computerized their processes. In fact, this is one of the thing which is part of the service level agreement between the PPP partner and the government. But one thing is always becomes a problem is handing over the original document back, because for one reason or another, people say that, sir, bandwidth is low, central server is not accepting the scanned document. For one reason or another, the original document return is not happening within the same day. So any reform measure should include this, that it should be given within a day. In fact, including Maharashtra, most of the states say that it should be given within 30 days. But Government of India liberally has given us one day. If we should be in a position to hand over. This needs certain improvements in your software, like saying that unless until you scan and hand over your document within another half an hour or 1 hour, further registration should be put on hold. Something like drastic steps we have to take. Otherwise, there is a tendency for the people to keep it, scan it later on, and if the scanning is not taking place immediately, then take it for granted, it will accumulate for 3 days, 4 days, 7 days, then 1 month. So this can be given. This is only ensure bandwidth and ensure proper scanning. This is something which needs to be done. Fee details, on the one hand, we feel that how much fees to be paid is not known to everyone. But by and large, it is not known to the people, because it is not easy to understand. Please keep it in mind, if you ask any reasonably educated person what is the income tax rate, he will tell. But you ask him what is the stamp duty rate and registration, he will never know. Because it is by nature. Income tax you have to pay every year, so it is better you know personally. But on the other hand, registration and stamp duty, most of the people in the country can afford at the most only one purchase or one sale, except a few people who are in the business of selling and purchasing, including the builders and the real estate people. Otherwise, we purchase once in a lifetime. So it doesn't make any sense for the people to understand everything. They just outsource it to either an advocate or a facilitator, etc. the problem comes there if the people are not having the information about the fees, then they may get cheated. What people end up saying that stamp duty may be 50,000 for the document, but they will tell the people that it has to be 75,000, but I will negotiate with the office and I will bring it to 50,000. Actual amount is only 50,000, but they will tell something different and they will then make some money out of that. So we have to ensure that this is publicly available and the customer is made known about the actual amount which has to be paid. Another thing which is related to computerization or reform is that if you are already having the registration computerized and if you are already having the ROR computerized, it's a very simple mechanism of both speaking to each other. Basically, the data for registration should be taken from the record of rights database. Many states have started doing. If the data is taken, two things happen. One, the false or fraud transaction do not take place by misleading. If one person name is there, other person cannot sell. So the name and details should come from the ROR database to registration database. Two, if the data is imported, now the data is very clear that it has been sold, then it can trigger a mutation automatically. So earlier we used to send only the information, then we information in a document PDF format, then we started sending a data. Now we do send the data and we generate a mutation number. So mutation number is auto generated and communicated through SMS to the concerned person saying that this is now mutation is started. Now the notice, issue of notice and other process will start. This is a very simple integration if the ROR and registration computerization is over. Computation of property tax, we didn't do something separately. Computation of property tax is done by the municipal corporations. This is a property tax levied by the municipal bodies, not by government. And this data is available with the concerned municipal administration, that is a municipal council or corporation at their level. Because most of the council have computerized that, we only linked with them. Again, it is only a service. They are very happy to share this with us because they get the money collected. So we just linked with them.
Okay. So my question was that to make this, whether they paid it or not, what is the effect on registration, sir? If the person has not paid, this is the first question, sir. And is there any provisions made in the notification, either in the rules or in the stamp act, I mean, Registration Act, so that we can take any action against if they are not paid the due?
Most of the time, we don't need rules and regulations to get this done. Our intention is to bring it to the knowledge of the purchaser that you are purchasing a property with an encumbrance. So the once this is brought to the knowledge, immediately the purchaser ensures that the seller pays for that. But most importantly, let me tell you very clearly, our sub-registrars are really very powerful. Whatever they say in the office, our people do. We don't need any rules and regulations. Our people go and say that, if sub-registrar say that, please sign here. Please go and watch any office. This is, you can see, people sign there. I am not saying that someone is taking wrong signature. But if the sub-registrar decides, 99% of the people will pay without any legal changes. Anyway, my answer is, it is not.
Thank you, sir. Thanks so much.
No, reform does not mention that you have to collect. Reform says that the customer should know that there is a due. Once this is made known to the people, the work is done.
From Jharkhand, ma'am. And my question is, sir, point number 76, published fee detail on department website for the following. And point number, the sub-point number 3, that says mutation name changes at ULB. In Jharkhand, there is no charges for mutation or name changes at ULB. So what will be our evidence? At a letter from department that we don't have any charges, because we cannot show charges. We don't have charges. So what will be the evidence?
Mutation fee is not compulsory. Mutation fee, if it is there, you have to mention what is the fee. Maharashtra also doesn't have a mutation fee, both for land records as well as municipal administration. If there is no fee, you can just inform the government of India that there is no fee. That is not an issue. If there is a fee, it should be published.
And my second question is, sir, point number 79, 80 and 81, that is changes land use. So we have no option for land use. We have no such law for land use. So what will be the evidence for that? A letter from department or what?
Basically, I am not very sure whether there is a land use doesn't need any permission. Most of the land revenue laws in the country presumes that the land should be used only for agriculture. And whenever there is a changeover to non-agriculture purpose, the permission from the district administration or from planning department is needed. And if it is not there, obviously the chief secretary or the revenue secretary can write, we don't have any procedure for land use change. Actually, you will get a benefit that one procedure itself is removed for doing these things. But you have to be very sure that there is no procedure of change of land use.
My next question is point number 77 that says integrate starting process of mutation with the registration process and allow intimation of mutation as soon as the deed is registered. The bracket says including land record office, ULB and utilities. Our land record is complied, but ULB and utilities, so multiple departments are involved. So what will be the process, sir? So we have to coordinate with all department, or the land record is complied, that means the point is complied.
The most important thing in the priority order is, first one is land record. As you rightly told, that you can easily integrate with land records. The second most important is the urban local body, because they keep what is called occupant record, while the government departments hold what is called holdership record. Who is the holder? The occupant may be same, occupant may be different. So ULB linkage has to take place. And please note that most of the, except a few places where it is not there, many of the urban local bodies have computerized these things. We have to just establish a linkage. There are two types of linkages. If they are online or if they are in the central server, then you can speak to the server directly and update. For your information, Mumbai Corporation have done a great work of making the updation very easy. Earlier, like any other mutation, once the information goes, they used to issue notice. Then someone has to say that there is no objection. Then they used to do that. Now the municipal corporation commissioner took who later became the chief secretary of Maharashtra. What sir has done is that he told that when the land record department is saying that the name has been changed, why should urban local body send a different notice asking for objection? He told that it is instant updation of ULB occupant record. So today when I send the data, the corporation simply updates the data provided their data and the registration data, name and the details match, obviously. Otherwise, there has to be a formal process of matching. So ULB is the second most important thing. As far as the utility is concerned, you know better that even before government has computerized, utility started computerizing. What are the utilities? One, water. Water is again with the urban local body. If you are tying up with them, automatically water will take place. Another most important utility is electricity boards or electricity distribution companies. They also computerize those things. So in Maharashtra, we have linked up with the land records. We have linked up with urban local bodies. But name updation with the utilities is yet to take place. But it's not a big job. There will be, most of the states will be having less number of utilities. You may be having 3-4 all government, except in some places it will be more. For example, Mumbai has best as well as some private operators, but it will not be very high. But if you are speaking at the state level, number of urban local bodies may be very heavy, very high. For example, Maharashtra has around 350 municipal councils. Now integrating with 350 municipal council may be a little difficult. So director of municipal administration started creating even before we asked. He is creating a centralized database based on property tax register. So we are going to link up with that director of municipal administration's property tax database. But yes, I agree, unlike a land record, ULB has many databases. But I think utility has less number of databases than ULBs, because ULB may be many, but then you have to take up with the director of municipal administration or secretary urban development to make a uniform, single, integrated database through which these things can happen.
Sir, one last question. Point number 71. That is very big, the parameter, and there are multiple departments are involved. Basically, we have problem with the point number four, revenue code case data, and 5, civil code case data, and 6, sir. So these are very very tough to comply. So how we do this point? Because some point are already complied, but few are very tough.
I agree with you. Revenue court, again, we have to, if it is, there is no computerized court monitoring system, we have to do that again. We have a revenue court software which is called EQJ courts, quasi judicial courts. Any quasi judicial court can use that. Again, it is NIC made. If you people want, that can be handed over. But software making is a small part. We have to ensure that all the revenue courts in the state use that. We have to ensure that the softwares are easier for them. For example, now the software ensures that notice can be served, notice can be generated automatically, next date can be given, and SMS can be sent to the parties about the date of hearing. Then uploading of judgments. Many a time the judgments are not uploaded to the central server. So what we did is that you have to upload and take a number, a code. Unless and only put that code in the document, it will not be treated as a valid judgment. Something like these things need to be done. So we have done that. Yes, revenue court, the revenue secretary of your state has to issue instructions that all the revenue court should use this system only. Then only you can link up and provide the pending cases. Civil courts comes under the purview of the e-courts, which is monitored by e-courts committee of the Supreme Court of India. And we have taken up with them. It's a centralized system. So you can integrate with them. The main problem with that database and our database is that while our database, the fulcrum is the survey number, and the e-court doesn't have a survey number. It depends on, it has an option for survey number. As it is an optional data, no one is filling in. So it's a very difficult job to, as of now, someone has to force entry of the survey number in the court database. But this is a joint work we have to take up with DOLR and as well as with the madam in DPIIT. But this is a work in progress. But revenue court is at our level, we should be in a position to do. Two more central authorities you can do. Ministry of Corporate Affairs has already linked with us. You can also, MCA company charges, you can link up. Likewise, CERSAI can also be linked up. Both have made their services available to us. Once service is developed, giving it to other states is not a big issue. Only you have to consume those services. I hope I covered the points you have raised as far as the common portal is concerned.